Hello friends, I welcome all of you to Mannan's e-learning program. In today's technical lecture, I will be talking about isolation of genomic DNA from yeast cells. Although my focus will be for the yeast cells, but more or less the process of isolation of genomic DNA, whether it is a prokaryotic cells, whether it is a yeast eukaryotic cell which is unicellular, or genomic DNA isolation from human blood or from cell lines, is more or less is same. Now the first question one should able to understand, that why would someone like to isolate a genomic DNA? The very first thing which you can see here is the gene cloning, which you can say is one of the foundation or the basic technique which is used in the recombinant DNA technology, which revolutionized the whole concept of biotechnology. Now, to clone a particular gene, one has to isolate the genomic DNA. So for a gene cloning purpose, whether one has to study a gene, or someone want to create some mutations or certain permutation and combinations, one has to isolate the genomic DNA. The genomic DNA can isolation, as I mentioned, for mutational studies, because for to study a function of a particular gene, there are two approaches. Either you mutate that particular gene or you overexpress that gene. These are the two ways essentially that you can study your gene. For this you are also want to isolate genomic DNA. The other could be for the preparation of a genomic library. Now in case of yeast, because as I will be focus on the yeast cells only, one can find out in yeast, by the way, there are roughly 6,000 genes, and out of these 4,000 genes or so which are non-essential. So one can create a disruption or deletion library of yeast gel, yeast genomic DNA, means yeast whole genome, and it is commercially available. Now once the other purpose which can be used is for genomic sequencing. One wants to know what is the genome size, then also they have to isolate genomic DNA. Besides this, there could be several other applications. I have just enlisted few of them. For example, the genomic DNA has very important from a crime scene investigation and has a forensic applications. There also a genomic DNA has to be isolated. Now, as I mentioned in the beginning, that the essentially the process of genomic DNA is the same, because DNA which is present in the nucleus, as you most of all you know, that is the deoxyribonucleic acid. So the first cell, whether it is a plant cell, whether it is an animal cell, whether it is a prokaryote bacteria, or let's say it is a unicellular eukaryotic organism, the first thing, whether it is, again, the cell types could be cell wall membrane bound, that is the cell wall is present and then followed by the plasma membrane, or maybe the simple like animal cells which has got only the plasma membrane but no cell wall. The first thing which one has to do is one has to break open the cell. And to break open the cell, we use the lysase buffer. Again, the chemistry of the lysase buffer different from different labs, and as well as the commercial sources of this is also different. Like some people use like certain anionic detergent, in some places they use a cationic detergent. Like for example, in plant cell, people use a C-tab detergent. SDS, which is used for say the yeast or in the prokaryotic system as a detergent. And so essentially what I'm trying to say, that you have to burst open with use of certain detergent or one can use certain heat and thaw method, liquid nitrogen methods, or whatever the mechanical force. One has to break the cells. Once you have broken the cell, the next essential step, which is, you can say, the separation of the nucleic acid, and we are talking about the DNA, okay, from the proteins. This is the second step, and the third step is the precipitation of the DNA, because when you open the cell, there are several cellular components. If you are talking about macromolecules like DNA, RNA and protein, then with the DNA, yeah, the RNA will come, and as well as there are certain proteins will come. Sometimes even this DNA is intermingled, like in case of the nucleosome. So one has to separate that DNA from the nucleosomes or the histone proteins, then it becomes very important. So these are, you can say, categorized into these three steps, that is the lysis, separation of the proteins from the DNA, and the precipitation step. And we will be talking about that in a few subsequent slides. Now, if you look into a typical, in this particular diagram, it has been shown that you take a tissue, okay, this tissue is basically talking about the human tissues. There is extraction buffer. We will not fall into the details of this extraction buffer, but as I said, these components consist of certain buffers, certain salts, and certain detergents. For yeast cells, obviously I am going to talk about that, what the lysis buffer composition is, but for other systems, as I am saying, it is, this whole protocol is applicable, is consist of a extraction buffer, and the time points has also been shown here, that you basically make a grind fast, that is, you are basically using a pistol and mortar or a homogenizers to break open the cells. Then you extract with the extraction buffer. Then you basically added a salt, like potassium acetate has been added. Then you are also adding PCI. PCI stands for your phenol chloroform isoamyl alcohol in a ratio of 25, 24 and 1. This is going to denature your proteins. Then you use some centrifugal force to separate out. Then you precipitate the DNA with the help of ethanol or isopropanol. This is a standard procedure in a flowchart diagram, which is more or less is applicable to all of the systems. Okay, all of the systems as there. Then there is a washing steps, as is 70% ethanol and TE buffer. So what I am going to talk about this procedure specifically for the yeast cells. But as I said, the principle is same for all the cell types. Now, why I am saying that there is a difference in different cell types, a link has been given, you can visit to see this link. But what you are finding here, that the extraction methods could be solution based or a solid phase methods. There are different methods, like one can use a organic solvents, some chaotropic reagents can be used, a mechanical glass beads can be used, magnetic beads, means you can find each, the so many flavors of this in the literature. The cell lysis, people have used Tritonex 100, SDS or SDS in a combination of proteinase K to break open the cell. They can use lysozymes, for example, for bacteria. For yeast, they can use lyticase or gyamulase. Heat can be used with a liquid nitrogen. The denaturation of the nucleoproteins, as I was mentioning earlier, this can be used with the help of proteinase K, or it can be used by the phenol, which the method which I just showed in the previous slide, or it can be used by guanidinium thiocyanates. Or a Chilex buffer can be used. Chilex buffer is mostly used in the forensic investigation, where the amount of DNA is very less. Then you want to precipitate out your DNA, then you can use several salts, as well as you can see here the Chilex or diameters are sodium chloride, polyethylene glycol, which has been there. So, and you then give the washing step, means you separate out DNA from the all other macromolecules. Now, one thing which usually comes, like when you isolate a genomic DNA, that RNA also comes with your DNA. Then for that purpose, people also often use like triazole reagent for the extraction of the DNA. Some people specifically use certain different chemistry, like they use a magnetic beads, okay, or there are several other materials which is like silica matrix is also used for ion exchange methods as well. So you will find several flavors, as I said, and this paper which is mentioned, you can find out the more details. My idea here is to into 15 to 20 minutes to give you an idea that how this process works, what is the principle, what are the basic steps. So now if we have to categorize broadly, as you saw in the previous slide also, we can categorize the genomic DNA isolation in two ways, that is the enzymatic method and one is the mechanical method. I will focus for my subsequent slide for the mechanical method. Now both have its advantages as well as disadvantages. Like enzymatic method, in case of yeast cells, if I am specifically say, certain enzymes is used, like one can use lyticase or they can use a gymolase. Okay, this is usually used, lyticase or gymolase, for break open the cell wall, and then you have to use a spiroplast which is created. So you use a isotonic solution like sorbitol. That's the method people use. Now this enzymatic method is not you can say very good method, like you get a very good yield of your genomic DNA, but this is not appropriate for kinetic experiments. Kinetic experiments means when you need a very fast measurements, you want to see the processes to be in a very fast way, or you want that everything should be because these enzymes can sometimes affect certain other processes, so that's why you don't use it. So then people goes with a mechanical method, which is comparatively more economical and time saver. And in case of the yeast cells, the mechanical method, which is one of the preferred method, is the glass beads methods. For this, bead beater is used, or a vortex machine which is used. People also use like heat and thaw method as well. So as I said, I will be focusing more here in the mechanical method, but I will just give you an idea here, like in terms of enzymatic method. Like if you see, like in this particular diagram shown the lyticase, like if you, when it is been used, so in this particular the top line diagram, you can say the yeast without a lyticase for a time period of 20 minutes time, which has been shown, and the OD, so it remains same. But as soon as you added the lyticase, which is basically beta 1,3 glucanase, then it's starts decreasing. Why? Because the cell wall starts bursting out, and if you do not provide an isotonic solution, the cell lysis will take place. In the mechanical method, the essential steps which you can see here, that you use the centrifugal force, or you can use heat thaw, as I said, or you can use a glass beads method, and for this you use certain detergents. Like for example, in this it has been shown that you take a yeast colony, and how this yeast colony is been grown. I have mentioned this in my previous lecture, in which I have talked about that how you can basically measure the cell size. That is one video you can refer to that, and as well as you can see in this that particular lecture that how the yeast cell can be grown. Okay, so for this, or you want to stain the yeast cells, so I will share a link, you can always visit that. So this is shown is a colony of the yeast cells, you culture them, after this you centrifuge them, you either use certain buffer or you use a glass beads. If you are using a glass beads, then basically you are using a vortex machine or a bead beater. If you are using a chelex, you can use a heat thaw method as well directly. And as they have shown here, they have used a 100 degrees Celsius temperature. So in this method, they they have used both, that is glass beads as well as the temperature. But one can also with a glass beads without using the temperature also gets a very good result. I have myself published one paper which is related with RNA, not the DNA isolation. I will share that in my link. Even in my previous video I have mentioned it. Now how does it looks like? Okay, so if see, this is taken from a Future Science. Okay, you can visit to this website. What they have shown in this basically picture, this is more about talking about what is the use of the Chelex buffer, what is its advantages. If you see, when you vortex it, okay, when you vortex it for 10 seconds 1 minute, and you can see that there is an increase in the yield of the genomic DNA. This is, by the way, is the snapshot of a agarose gel, and they have just shown the picture just to show in comparison that what is the effect of the time. As you can increase the time with the heat, okay, then the yield will be more. And that's why they have shown here at the bottom, like if they have used the 100 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes, they are getting. But as I mentioned here, that even if you use the glass beads without the heat method, and if you want to do for gene cloning purpose, then this method perfectly works all right. There is no need for the heating step. Even people use, like as I said, freeze thaw methods can be also used. That also gives a very good quality of genomic DNA. If we want to make a library, then I would suggest that one should use a liquid nitrogen based method or an enzymatic method. But if someone wants to just isolate the genomic DNA for a PCR purpose or a gene cloning purpose or a mutation case purpose, then they can follow a mechanical method. Now if we look into the mechanical methods, just to give you again a little bit more detail, like what are the buffers. So I just focused in the mechanical method. There is a breaking buffer. The breaking buffer is used a Triton X100, the SDS which is used, the NaCl, the tris chloride EDTA which is used, and then the ammonium acetate. This ammonium acetate is used for the precipitation of the DNA. Now this information which I am showing you is from my PhD thesis, which I submitted 10 years back. So you can always visit to this link. This is the CSIR lab, and you can see my thesis details as well. It is in Shodh Ganga and it is freely available. Then I am just telling you from that how I have isolated the genomic DNA using a mechanical method, because this is a routine practice which we used to do. So the yeast DNA was isolated from a 10 ml culture by glass beads method, and we followed the Oshpe et al, which is the current protocols in molecular biology method with few modification. And those modification is that we have precipitated, means after lysing of the cells at other steps, we have used the RNAs in our DNA preparation. And as I mentioning in, if you recall in the previous slide, we use the RNAs because we do not want that RNA should be a contaminating agent, and for this we incubated at 37 degree at 30 minutes. Then we have used a phenol chloroform isoamyl alcohol for denaturation of the proteins and to remove the nucleoprotein complex. Then the precipitation of the DNA is done by the salting out phenomenon by using the ammonium salt and two volumes of ethanol. People can use NaCl plus isopropanol can also be used. But if you want the very good quality in terms of very less salt contamination, then ethanol is preferred, and this ethanol is the absolute ethanol. These are the centrifugal force and the temperature. Then the DNA pellet which you are getting is air dried, and then they are stored in 30 to 50 microliters of TE buffer, and then you can keep it in minus 20 degrees or minus 80 degrees Celsius, and they remain there as such for a month time without any degradation. Now There are several papers, like I came across when I was preparing this lecture. This is one paper which I came across. The link has been shown here as well, that they have used a yeast genomic DNA extraction with lithium acetate and SDS method. And what's the author's claim? This is a paper from Estonia, by the way, that even they don't need any enzymes for this. Just simple vortexing is required. There is no need for bead beater, which is often used for mechanical genomic DNA isolation, and they have got a very good quality of DNA. So this is just to give you a flavor, like what kind of different, because there is no end, like we can go on to talk about several methods of genomic DNA isolation. But what I put this also to show you in a gel how it's appeared. Like for example, the genomic DNA will be appeared in the top if you are using a 1 kb ladder. For, let me change color code. If you are using a running a gel of 1 kb, then the genomic DNA will be on the topmost band, above even 10 kb. Okay, so that is genomic DNA. There are certain RNA contamination. If you have not used the RNAs, that's why they are showing here. If you treat with the RNAs, then this RNA is gone, as you can see from this bottom lane and this bottom lane. And because of the same reason, even our own lab protocol in the ImTech Chandigarh, from where I did the PhD, also mentioning the same thing, that we don't give with the RNAs treatment. The people use this RNAs maybe at the beginning, or some people do at the end. Both works fine. And as you can see, with the increasing, they have used different permutation and combination. You can always visit to this link to find out more in detail. So friends, I would like to stop here. Maybe I will take 1 or 2 minutes to summarize and to give you an idea that what are the tools which is required for genomic DNA. So far I have mentioned here that what are the basic principle of isolation of genomic DNA. The principle is applicable for each cell types. Essentially, it involves the breaking of the cells. Then you have to separate the DNA from the nucleoproteins or the proteins which is present, precipitate the DNA out. That is the three basic steps which has been involved. Mechanical enzymatic methods, which is mostly preferred. They have both pros and cons over there. I've also shown to you my own work, that is how we use the mechanical method. I've also shown to you that how you can use a different buffer method, like for example lithium acetate or SDS method. What is the yield, how it will appear in the gel, what is the application of this whole process. Now, for isolation of genomic DNA, you might require like incubator shaker, spectrophotometer, laminar hood, centrifugal machines, as you can see here. As you can see here in this particular thing shown, there is incubator, spectrophotometer, laminar hood. There are certain enzymes which you require if you're using enzymatic methods, glass beads, PCI, ammonium acetates, and these things are required. I have mentioned about this in my previous lecture as well, that if you want to take a growth curve analysis, or if you want to give the cell cycle, cell size and staining of the cells, then you also require some of these reagents. I will be sharing my link so that you can visit it. But essentially the incubator shaker looks like this, spectrophotometer, laminar hood. If you are visiting the first time, then you can, just for your sake, I am just showing this. Centrifugal machine looks like this. Yeast cells will be looking something like this. The media components will be like this. With this, friends, I will stop here. If you like my video, and if you need updated videos like this, please subscribe to my channel. And thank you very much.